Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Latin American webinar of physics. I am Roberto Lineros. I'm going to be the host for this webinar. Today, we have a very interesting talk. It's going to be about the direct detection of dark matter. So first of all, remember that you can follow us in our social networks, and especially in this YouTube channel. You are watching now the live transmission, but if you are watching in the future, you can maybe consider to subscribe to the YouTube channel. So today's webinar is very interesting, as I said before, because it's going to be by Maria Luisa Sarsa. She's professor at the University of Zaragoza in the Centro de Astropartículas y Física de Altas Energías from that university. And she's going to talk about the Canfranc Underground Laboratory. And the title of her webinar is the dark matter wind blowing at the Canfranc Underground Laboratory? Welcome, Marisa, and you
Thank
can
you
start
very much.
The webinar whenever you want.
Thank you. So I'm going to share my slides. Okay, so you are seeing them. It's okay? Okay.
Yes, we can.
Perfect. So then, it's my pleasure to be here and to present the recent results of the experiments I'm working in, that is the ANAIS experiment I will present you later. I will want to thank the organizer for the opportunity to try to answer for you this question. Is the dark matter wind blowing at the Canfranc Underground Laboratory? So to follow the talk, more or less, I will cover the following topics. I will introduce the direct detection of dark matter and the annual modulation effect that is expected in the dark matter interaction rates. I will move then to the DAMA LIBRA positive result, which has an associated long-standing puzzle covering really all the field of dark matter direct detection. I will present the ANAIS 112 experiment. That is the focus of my research, and the recently published result on the annual modulation corresponding to 3 years of data that have been very recently published in Physical Review there. This is the article that, as you can see, has been considered as editor suggestion and also featured in the Physics magazine by the editors of the APA, the APS. So just a very brief introduction, because probably all of you know about dark matter. The evidence on the existence of dark matter come from very different observational techniques, different scales, and different times of the universe evolution, from galaxies to clusters of galaxies and larger scale structure, but also from the present back to the recombination and nuclear primordial nucleosynthesis period of the universe. And we have a cosmological model that is very successful to explain all of these observations, but at the expense of introducing a 27% of the energy and mass of the universe in the form of an invisible and non-baryonic matter, which is called dark matter. This is the main topic, of course, how to look for this dark matter in the universe. There are a lot of candidates on the scene. They are covering orders of magnitude in mass and cross-section. And we know very, very few things about this particle that we are searching for. But the most important thing is that none of the particles we know has the right properties. And so we had to look beyond the standard model of particle physics, what could be this dark matter. The best motivated candidates are coming from contexts different from the astrophysical context. So they, in general, are proposed for different parts of the particle physics. And I will focus on WIMPs because they are a very convenient dark matter candidate. They are weakly interacting massive particles, and they are really a very wide category of candidates. These particles have been thermally produced in the early universe, and they have the very nice property that at freeze out, the annihilation cross-section determines a relic abundance that is compatible with the observed abundance of dark matter. This is the called wind miracle, and it makes that for a GeV particle in the scales of the weak interactions, we can explain the dark matter problem. Moreover, these candidates allow for direct detection and also indirect detection and also production at colliders because they are coupled to dark matter to standard model particles. So you can see here in the diagram how these dark matter particles could annihilate and then produce cosmic rays, for instance, that could be searched for in satellites, but dark matter particle could interact with the standard model particle and then produce a release of energy in our detectors, that is what I will call direct detection, but also two standard model particles interacting between them can produce dark matter particles at colliders. So this is a quite a good thing for a candidate that could be detectable. And so this is the direct detection approach. Most of the experiments I will comment follow. For detecting dark matter, we need that the particle coupled to the standard model particles by the somehow a weak interaction. And some energy could be released in the interaction with our detectors. Of course, we need very sensitive and radio poor particle detectors because we expect these particles release a very, very small amount of energy and also that the interaction occur very, very rarely in the detectors. Because of that, we have to shield our experiments against all the possible background contributions that could hide the signal we are searching for. And because of this, we are going to underground laboratories to seal the cosmic rays, but also introduce our detectors in very large shielding to protect against environmental radioactivity. And also, if possible, use the most innovative and successful background rejection techniques, developing new technologies. But even in this case, how to be sure that we are finding the dark matter? How to be sure about a positive result of dark matter? For this, the key is to analyze a specific signature of the dark matter particle that is not shared by other backgrounds. And in this sense, I will commend the annual modulation, which is one of the most interesting features of these dark matter interactions, but there are also other possibilities. And it is very interesting, for instance, to develop detectors that are sensitive to the direction of the nuclear recoil produced by the interaction of the dark matter particle. Coming to this interaction of these WIMPs with ordinary matter, as I have said before, a small transfer of energy in the form of a nuclear recoil is expected in most of the models of the WIMPs, but there are other options because we don't have really an idea of which is the interaction of the particle we are searching for. In any case, the interaction rate depends strongly on the specific WIMP particle properties. That means the mass and the interaction cross-section with the nuclei our detectors are made of. The dependence is also on the Hallow model, not only in the density of these particles in the galaxy, but also in the distribution of velocities at the position of the solar system, that is where our detector is sitting. And this this interaction rate is quite an involved combination of these dependencies, particle and Hallow properties dependencies. And as I said before, which could be the interaction mechanism for the particles we are searching? The WIMP interaction rate will change strongly depending on this interaction cross-section, which is unknown, and contains the details from the dark matter particle model at the microscopic level. I want to say that is dependent on the coupling of the dark matter particle with the standard model particle, quarks and elementary particles. To arrive to this cross-section, we have to take into account the target nuclear structure and then to use the nuclear properties of the system in order to derive this total cross-section with our nuclei. In principle, the most general case can be described by means of an effective field theory having 15 possible operators that could describe the most general interaction between a particle that we have no idea what it is with a target nucleus. And this is quite complicated because these parameters have dependencies, some of them in the velocity, but in some complicated way with the spin of the nucleus in very different shapes. the energy dependence, the energy rate is plot here. For instance, you can see here the standard spin independent term, that is the O1 operator, which is the easiest to consider. And it produces energy release in our detector that has enormous exponential shape, not very easy to distinguish from backgrounds. For different mass of the particle, we obtain different energy depositions, but other of these operators will produce very different spectral shapes for the energy deposition in the detectors, because they depend on the velocity of the particles in quite an important way. That means that we don't have much an idea about what we are looking for in our detector, which could be the nuclear recoil energies we have to observe in our detectors. And this is more complicated when we try to compare experiments that are using different target nuclei, because this rate has the dependencies quite introduced in the calculation. What is the usual procedure to compare experiment? We take a given interaction model for the WIMPs. In general, we consider only this O1 operator, that is the easiest one. We consider spin-independent interacting WIMPs because the rate scales very easily with the square number of nucleons in the target. In this case, the comparison between experiment is quite easy because the scaling is easy. We have here the square reduced mass and the number of nucleons in the target for the comparison. And so we can plot the nucleon WIMP cross-section. But this is only one of the possible couplings between the dark matter particle and the nucleus we are studying. It's only one of the possible operators, is the usually adopted to compare experiments because it's the easiest one. The same is happening with the halo model. How are the dark matter particles distributed in the halo? Well, we don't know. We have more or less some indication about the simulation of the and a particle and gravitational coupling in very large systems, but we don't have really a measurement of the halo distribution for the velocity of the dark matter particles. So because of that, to compare different experiments, we use the standard halo model, which assumes an spherical and isotropic distribution of the particles of dark matter in the halo, and then a Maxwellian distribution of velocities, which is truncated at the escape velocity of the halo. This is also model-dependent assumption, and if we change this the velocity distribution in the rates, we change the results. And we change in correlation with the target nucleus mass and properties in a quite complicated way. The halo is quite important because, in general, experiments are only sensitive to the tail of the distribution above a given energy, a minimum energy or velocity of the WIMPs, because the threshold energy of the experiment, which is also different from one experiment to another, makes this dependence quite important in some cases. And you will hear later because this is important. But so, yeah, I can now explain what is the annual modulation that we expect in the dark matter interaction rate. It's an effect because the Earth is moving around the Sun along the year with the orbital motion with a period of 1 year, as you know. The Earth velocity is around 30 kilometers per second, but the ecliptic plane is tilted with respect to the galactic plane in which the Sun is moving around the center of our galaxy. And this is like we are moving inside the dark matter halo, and then we are moving through the WIMPs. So then is this, because I put in the title of my talk, the WIMP wind. There is a wind of WIMPs coming to the Earth, to our detectors, and this wind is modulated along the year. This wind is not blowing at the same rate in June than in December, because the velocity of the Earth with respect to the Sun is in the same direction or in the opposite direction along the year, and then we add our velocity to that of the Sun, or we are subtracting that. And this is not a large effect because we are seeing only about 13 kilometers per second more in June than in March, and 13 kilometers per second less in December. But this effect can be noticeable, and it produces a modulation in the interaction rate of particles. This is what we should observe for spin-independent interacting winds in summer and in winter. It is a very, very slight difference, but if we compare, so we look at the modulation amplitude that correspond to this difference between summer and winter, we will obtain a clear effect at different energies that is really very, very characteristic of the dark matter in the halo, because this period, the phase of the motion, and even the size of the effect is really not shared by backgrounds, and it's really a very distinctive feature of the dark matter interaction. As I told you, the effect is small. It should produce an inverse modulation at low energies. As you can see here, the modulation amplitude is expected to be positive for these spin-independent interacting winds at larger energies, but at a given point that depends on the mass of the nucleus and of the WIMP, the modulation should convert to negative modulation, and it's strongly dependent on the halo model. So what we expect for the standard halo model is what we are showing here, but for another halo models, we should observe a different phase and a different magnitude of the effect. And so this is what an experiment in Italy, DAMA LIBRA, has been observing for more than 20 years. They have been observing a modulation in the interaction rate observed by their detectors. Their detectors were at the beginning only 100 kilograms of sodium iodide detectors, starting the measurements in 1995, but they upgrade experiment to 250 kilograms after 2003, and they are still taking data. The last results of the DAMA LIBRA experiment were released in March 2018. And in this case, for the second phase of the experiment, they improved the performance of the experiment, reducing the threshold to 1 keV, replacing all the PMTs, all the photomultipliers, with high quantum efficiency photomultipliers. So the experiment has more than 20 years of data, and what they observe is really this kind of modulation in the interaction rates that is here for only the 14 last years, so they have still more data before of that, that have a very, very high statistically significant result for the presence of modulation. More than 12 sigma confidence level is what is attributed to this modulation signal observed. And this modulation has the proper features that are expected for dark matter interaction modulation. They observe only the modulation at very low energies, below 6 keV of energy, not at the higher energies as it should be produced. They don't observe the modulation for the backgrounds, for instance, when looking at events happening at the same time in two of the modules. The coincidence are attributed to background because the probability that the dark matter particle produce two interactions at the same time in the detectors is really negligible. And in principle, none of the systematics that have been proposed to explain this modulation is able to reproduce correctly the observation of the experiment of DAMA LIBRA. This modulation, as I told you before, can be interpreted as produced by WIMPs, but this is a model-dependent interpretation. So in this case, I have chosen a model, and in this case, for instance, is the spin-independent isospin-conserving interacting WIMPs and a standard halo, in order to find which parameters of the WIMP in terms of mass of the particle on coupling to the nucleons are compatible with the dark matter LIBRA result. And we obtain here these two regions in the parameter space, depending on the rate is dominated by sodium interaction or by iodine interactions. And so this is the compatibility with DAMA LIBRA result. And which is the experimental situation? The experimental situation is that only one experiment, DAMA LIBRA, observes a model-independent annual modulation compatible with dark matter. and moreover in the standard halo. But there are other much sensitive experiments that don't observe any hint of the interaction of these dark matter particles. And the comparison is model dependent. I saw for your information, the most recent comparison done in the frame of the APEC committee report that was released last April, very recently. You can see here the DAMA LIBRA regions I showed you before, and the results of many other very sensitive experiments around the world that don't observe anything compatible with the Malibra. These lines show the exclusion plots, the region of the parameters that are excluded by these experiments that are not compatible with the Gamma Libra result. So this makes a strong tension, not only for these candidates, but also assuming more general analog interaction models. However, as far as we don't know the properties of the particles we are searching for, this comparison is always model dependent. And this is a problem because we require a model independent confirmation or refutation of the Gamma Libra result. Is mandatory in order to answer the question, is the Malibra result a door into new physics or is just systematics? And to answer this question using the same target that the Malibra has used is really one of the main points for doing more direct the comparison. But it's not the only thing. Of course, using the same target, sodium iodide, as I said, is really very important because we could reduce many dependencies on the coupling to the nucleus of the WIMP, although these uncertainties are almost released, but a good knowledge of the detector response is required. And I will comment later on this question a little more. You can see here, according to APEC committee report, which is the status of the experiments of sodium iodide that are presently running or in preparation. You can see here, of course, the Malibra is still taking data and running, there are two experiments, ANAIS 112 and COSINE, and there are some experiments in preparation. Just to say a few words about ANAIS and COSINE, that they are both in data taking phase. ANAIS has 112 kilograms, is less than the Malibra. COSINE is only using 60 kilograms of mass, effective mass. They have a larger mass, but this is only the effective mass for the annual modulation search. They are taking data since 2016, and we are taking data since 2017. And then we are trying to confirm or refute the DAMA LIBRA result in the next few years. But other projects in preparation are, for instance, SABRE experiment, which is developing more radio poor crystals. And they plan to use two detector sites, one at the North Hemisphere in the Grand Sasso Laboratory, another in Australia in the Stowell Laboratory that is in construction, and also the COSINUS experiment that is also very interesting because it uses a different technique. They are planning to use bolometers of sodium iodide in order to search better for this different response to nuclear recoils that is produced or that is expected in scintillation detectors. So, concerning ANAIS. ANAIS stands for annual modulation with sodium iodide scintillators, and the goal is the confirmation of the Malibra result with the same target and technique. But of course, our experimental approach is different, and this will be the focus of the rest of my talk, and the environmental conditions that would affect systematics are also different. We are working at the Canfranc Underground Laboratory that is in Spain under 2,450 meters of water equivalent, and we are taking data since August 2017. We use a 3x3 matrix of modules, 12.5 kilogram each, that are cylindrical in shape and made by Alpha Spectra Company in the States. We have coupled in a second step at Canfranc Clean Room high quantum efficiency photomultipliers from Hamamatsu, and our data analysis, that is also a very important part of our work, is blind. The region of interest was blind from beginning, so I will comment a little more. Concerning Canfranc, it's a laboratory under the Spanish Pyrenees in a tunnel, the Somport Tunnel, which is connecting Spain to France with a rock overburden of 850 meters. That is a smaller rock over Barton than Gran Sasso Laboratory. You can see here the depth of Gran Sasso. And this implies that, for instance, all the possible systematics related with muon residual flux could be different and should affect in a different way our experiment than that of DAMA LIBRA. The relevant experimental features of ANAIS. So for instance, we work in collaboration with the company producing the crystals to build in Mylar windows in order to allow for low energy calibration. To have a robust energy calibration at the very low energies where the signal is expected is one of the most important points in the analysis of our experiment. We can calibrate with cadmium 109 sources mounted on flexible wires that are introduced and taken out our shielding periodically. Every 2 weeks, we can calibrate simultaneously all the 9 modules in our experimental setup. Our crystals have shown an excellent light collection. Scintillation is produced in the crystal by the energy deposition of a particle, and then we have to collect this light by the photomultipliers with the highest possible efficiency. In our modules, the light is collected at the level of 15 photoelectrons per keV, with a very, very large and homogeneous distribution of the light collection between all the modules. The lowest one has 12.7 photoelectrons per keV, and the highest one has 16 photoelectrons per keV. If you compare with DAMA LIBRA results, even in the second phase, which is the improved phase of the experiment, the light collection is between 6 and 10 photoelectrons per keV. This implies our detectors collected much better the light produced by the particles, and then our threshold energy and our response should be more should be better than that of DAMA LIBRA. We are monitoring continuously along the data taking this light collection, which is changing along the time, but we can correct by these drifts that we are still trying to understand by calibration and correcting any gain drift in the detectors. However, the total light collection is quite stable in all of our modules after the 3 years. And all of these parameters and the evolution of the parameters has been deeply studied in our last results paper I commented you before. This is our setup, and these are some pictures of the building. You can see here from outside to inside, we have polyethylene and water to moderate neutrons, an active muon beta consisting of 16 plastic scintillators, a tight box preventing the radon entrance into the shielding, 20 centimeters of lead with low activity, and the most internal part of our shielding are 2 centimeters of archaeological lead. All of this is our shielding to prevent the environmental radioactivity produce interference with our detection of dark matter. That is our goal. And in principle, this is different from DAMA LIBRA that has no active veto against the residual muon flux. Of course, in Canfranc is more important because, as I told you before, our residual muon flux is higher than in Gran Sasso. This was the commissioning in March 2017, and the data taking started in August 2017. Our data acquisition system has been very well tested with previous prototypes. We have the 2 signals from every pre-EMT after a particle interacting in the crystal is producing a light that is reaching the photomultipliers, and then the signal is processed by very nice MATAC digitizers with a high resolution, 14 bits and at 2 gigasamples per second. And we trigger with the AN between the 2 photomultiplier signals in a 200 nanosecond window. Our system is really very free of noise and is not affected by vibration of electrical contribution. But as I recommend you, our problem is a different one at the threshold position. So with these signals produced by our modules in this way, by this data acquisition system, we have to calibrate very well the light and to convert it into energy. And we do the calibration at the region of interest with a very high accuracy, combining the periodical external calibration lines of cadmium. This is a cadmium spectra obtained in the 9 modules. You can observe 3 lines below 100 keV at 18, 22, and 12 kiloelectron volts. And this is done every 2 weeks. And we combine this external calibration with potassium-40 and sodium-22 internal calibration contamination background lines at 3.2 and 0.9 kiloelectron volts. As background lines have smaller statistics, we use every 1.5 months of accumulation these events from the background in order to calibrate our experiment. And so then the region of interest is calibrated with four lines below 25 keV in order to take into account the nonlinear behavior of sodium iodide below 100 keV. And so our calibration is quite good in this regime. And these two lines are fully in the region of interest of our experiment. So then we can say that we are calibrating very, very nicely our experiment. These are the lines accumulating the time of measurement, 3.2 and 0.9 kiloelectron volts, selected by the coincidence with high energy gamma in a second module. And so then we are not affected by any problem with the triggering because it's done by the high energy gamma line. And we demonstrate that we are triggering below 1 keV. You can see here not only the line of sodium 22, but also the L capture in potassium 40 decay. We are observing events below 1 keV very nicely. But this is not our threshold energy because of other problems with experiment analysis that I will focus later. So the calibration is determined with these cadmium lines in the background, and we can correct any gain drift with this calibration procedure in a very robust way. And so after calibration, we can develop our analysis strategy. We have done this with the first year of data. We blind the events of interest that are even in the 1 to 6 keV energy region, and only single hit events, anti-coincidence events between modules. And for determining the fine-tuning analysis parameters and efficiencies for the selection procedures, we are using only M2 events in the ROE, which are due to background, for instance, the potassium 40 and sodium 22 events, but also the cadmium calibration events. And we unblind 10% of the first year of data for background assessment. But all this procedure was published before doing the first analysis in this 2019 paper in European Physics Journal C. With the first year analysis, we fixed the selection criteria, and we have kept this criteria for subsequent analysis. We have just updated efficiencies, but not changed the parameters of the filtering. And this is our filtering procedure. So our rate of events in the region of interest is dominated by non-scintillation of sodium iodide events. So we have to apply a strong event selection procedure. First, we select only single hit events to reject the backgrounds produced by radioactivity in the environment. We select also events arriving more than 1 second after a muon interacting in the beta system. This is because we want to reject all the possible muon-related events in our detectors. And then we have to remove these non-compatible with Boole scintillation events. They are some events that are too fast to be produced by scintillation in sodium iodide that has a scintillation constant of 250 nanosecond, but also too slow events that are associated with tails of pulses. And you will use a biparametric cut considering the tail of the scintillation pulse with respect to the total scintillation pulse and the distribution of the mean photoelectron arrival times. Moreover, we have to reject asymmetric events. That means events that have a strong signal in one photomultiplier but a weak signal in the second photomultiplier. These events are not compatible with the Boole scintillation in sodium iodide, and we establish the cut at the number of photoelectrons, the peaks. For instance, here you can see two peaks. We require more than 4 photoelectrons in every PMT of every module in order to keep the event as produced by as good scintillation events. So you can see here, this is our total rate, raw data. After applying this time behavior and biparametric cut, we reduce very strongly the events that are passing the cut, and you can observe here the peak that is appearing in our data. This is the potassium 40 background line that won't be observed if we should keep only raw data in the region of interest. So this is all the cuts we are applying. And you can observe really the effect below 10 keV, that is really the reducing strongly the interactions that we observe in our detectors. And these criteria of selection of events are the motivation of the analysis threshold we have to establish. But the parameters for the filtering were established, as told you before, before unblinding with the first year of data and using only population of events outside the region of interest. These are the efficiencies we have calculated with the cadmium, sodium, and potassium events that fix our analysis threshold at 1 keV, because we require that our efficiencies for keeping good scintillation events are larger than 10%. And for that, we have to go only down to 1 keV. The efficiencies are calculated detector by detector and are larger than 90%, about 2.5 keV. Below 2 keV, they strongly reduce down to 1 keV, which are at the level of 15 and 25%, depending on the detector module. So we use these efficiencies to correct, of course, our event rate after filtering in order to recover the estimated event rate at every energy. But we can check the goodness of this efficiency and the energy of calibration stability, for instance, using potassium and sodium population that are very well tagged by the high energy gamma that is triggering the detection in the second module, and then we are almost free from noise in this population. You can see here the events compatible with potassium 40, the evolution of the rate in the 3 years of data, and this is for sodium 22 behavior along the 3 years. In potassium, we observe a constant rate compatible with the half-life of the isotope that is of the order of billion of years. And in the case of sodium 22, we obtain a decay, an exponential decay that is compatible with the half-life of the sodium 22 isotope. So this is really a very good indication that our checking of good events is quite well established at the threshold, because these events are in the 1 keV energy region. So before presenting results, I have to comment that despite the large effort of ANAIS team looking for ultra-poor sodium iodide italian detectors, our background is worse than DAMA LIBRA. Our background in the region of interest is dominated by the crystal radioactivity. We have higher potassium 40 level and higher lead 210 level in our crystals than DAMA LIBRA has. This is the main a problem in our region of interest, but I have to stress that the quality of DAMA crystals has been still not reached by any experiment. Sabre and Cosine collaboration are working strongly and progressing towards more radiopoor crystal growing, but they are still having troubles with lead 210, for instance. So this is our background. Is worse than the DAMA LIBRA. We are a higher value than 2 counts per keV kilogram and day, between 2 and 4 in the region of interest. But we have a very good background model. So we understand our background is not good, but it's understood. In all the energy regions, it can be explained, but natural change led to 10, potassium 40 and tritium, but we underestimate the rate in the 1 to 2 keV energy region. You can see here more clearly in this plot, and we are working to understand this underestimate of this region of interest below 2 keV. But although this is quite important because it affects our region of interest, and we are working on machine learning techniques trying to reduce the possible leaking in our filtering protocols, because we think that this excess of events is related with our selection criteria, so we are trying to improve it. We remark that constant backgrounds shouldn't affect the annual modulation analysis. And we can say this because our model predicts very well the time evolution of the background detector by detector. You can see here which are the evolution of the rates that we expect in 3 years. Here is for more than 3 years, 3 years are more or less here. We can predict the behavior of our rates We are reproducing satisfactorily the time evolution observed, for instance, for background events in the 1 to 6 keV region. This is just adjusting to a factor F, our background model, that is just at a few percent of the unity. And here is for events in the outside the region of interest between 6 and 10 keV, that is also in the few percent level of our estimates of our background model. So we can use this to present our results on annual modulation. We published our first results in 2019 in Physical Review Letters, but now we have updated for more time, for more exposure, 300 kilograms per year, with a very excellent light duty cycle. 95% of our time is lifetime. And most of the downtime of our experiment is due to the calibration that are done every 2 weeks. So this is a very, very nice performance of our experiment. And we are using for the present results more than 1,000 days of data after removing muon tag related events. With respect to the previous analysis, we have improved our background modeling, and we have checked also some systematics and the consistency of the result. And we have simulated pseudo experiments by Monte Carlo to analyze possible bias and checking the sensitivity in our experiment. So what we do is to minimize the number of events that we observe in 10 days binning of our data. Considering a Poisson uncertainty, of course, and correcting conveniently by the lifetime of every beam and the efficiency for every energy region. In the case of this expected number of events, mi-e, we are considering a background modeling that I will comment now, and a term due to the modulation expected for the dark matter signal that has an amplitude that should be fixed to zero in the null modulation hypothesis and should be free in the modulation hypothesis study. The frequency would be fixed to 1 year period, and the phase should be fixed also to the 2nd of June for the maximum of the modulation as corresponding to the standard Halo model in order to compare with the Malibra experiment. So for the background modeling, we have considered two different background modelings, combining the detectors of the 9 modules together. An exponentially decaying background, we have 3 parameters. R0 is a background parameter that is including also the possible signal of dark matter that is average in time. Tau and F take into account the contribution for the background that is exponentially decaying, but here could be also any constant in time background contributing, as I commented before, in the region below 2 keV. A constant background should be included also in this R0 parameter, thanks to this term in the background modeling function. We have also taken the probability distribution function from the background modeling that I showed you before, corrected by a factor F and the R0 parameter, which is also lead free as noise parameters in our fitting. We obtained these results for the 2 modelings of the background and for the null hypothesis and the modulation hypothesis. You can see here the results for the p-values and for the modulation amplitudes that we are fitting. I will show you better later these values. We obtain better p-values in the 2 to 6 keV region and in the 1 to 6 keV region. I will comment a little on this later. But this is the comparison with the values obtained for the modulation of DAMA LIBRA. So here we have fixed the modulation amplitude to the DAMA LIBRA result. And you can see here how the p-value is much worse in both scenarios, in both energy region, with respect to the null hypothesis and to our best fit to a modulation hypothesis. The third modeling considers every detector individually and can take into account possible systematic effects related with the different backgrounds and efficiency of the different modules that we can observe here. In this case, the results are more difficult to see, but we reproduce quite nicely the behavior of all the detectors. Some detectors have very low p-values. We think that these detectors are the problem of the global low p-values in the 1 to 6 keV energy region. And we think that these detectors are affected by a worse filtering procedures selection criteria. And we are trying to correct this in the future for other analysis. However, this analysis combined for all the crystals has the smallest standard deviation. And this is the value fully compatible with all the other values derived from the other techniques that we have taken for comparing and presenting our results with respect to DAMA LIBRA. This is the modulation derived from our fitting in black points derived with respect to the DAMA LIBRA result that is shown in blue. You can observe how our best fits are incompatible with the DAMA LIBRA result at 3.3 sigma level and 2.6 sigma level in the two energy region that we are considering, for a sensitivity at the 2.5 and 2.7 level in these two energy region. The sensitivity is plotted as the green, yellow, and blue lines in this figure. And this is what we expected for our a priori sensitivity estimates. So these were our estimates in terms of sigma confidence level with respect to DAMA LIBRA, and we should be at 3 sigma from DAMA LIBRA result within the two scheduled 5 years of data taking. So we think that we are really very nicely reproducing our estimates and that we can be at this level next year, along next year, and the time we could need for the analysis of the results. Concerning our checking, just a brief comment. We have checked the beam size changing from 5 to 30 days, negligible effect on the results for the modulation. We have checked possible bias with our Monte Carlo pseudo experiments modulation. We observe no bias and our result is fully compatible with the standard deviation derived from the Monte Carlos. We have compared 1 to 2 years with respect to 2 to 3 years, and results are fully compatible. We have also released the phase of the modulation, and then we have observed with respect to DAMA that our result is biased, but any modulation search in this parameter space should be biased. And if we take into account this bias, we observe our result compatible at 1 sigma with 0 in all the, with the absence of modulation in all the phase of the parameter space. And we have also released the frequency. No statistically significant modulation at any frequency is observed in our data. So in principle, all of our results and tests are compatible with the absence of modulation. So I conclude by saying that we are searching for annual modulation since August 2017 with 112 kilograms of sodium iodide canfranc, and our experiment is running quite smoothly with very nice experimental features. With 3 years of data, the null hypothesis is well supported by all of our analysis, and the best fits are incompatible with the DAMA LIBRA for a sensitivity more than 2.5 by less than 3 sigma now, but best fits are incompatible already at 3 sigma level in the 1 to 6 keV energy region. So we confirm our sensitivity projections and we expect to reach in 2022 3 sigma level of the DAMA LIBRA test. However, before ending, and let me now a few words about, is this really a model-independent testing of the DAMA LIBRA result? And I hope you make some question about this issue, because using same target material shouldn't be just enough. The comparison is more direct, but the response of both detectors has to be very, very well known. And we don't know so well the response function of sodium iodide, especially for nuclear recoils. This is because of the quenching factor. The scintillation produced by nuclear recoils is quenched with respect to electron recoils, and this factor is required for the calibration scale to convert energy in terms of electron equivalent energies to nuclear recoil energies. And this is the present situation for sodium iodide quenching factors. This is the dispersion of experimental results that are present now in the literature. So there are still too many uncertainties in the quenching factors for sodium iodide, and this should be improved in order to say that two experiments, as the DAMA LIBRA and ANAIS, are the compatible or incompatible. In our case, we are measuring our quenching factor for different crystals, and we are trying to determine this quenching factor at the best level. We expect to have results very soon, but the comparison with DAMA-LIBRA will be still dependent on the results for DAMA-LIBRA crystals. We are also studying possible explication of the modulation signal in terms of, for instance, the muon possible modulation that has been suggested to explain DAMA-LIBRA many times, but the DAMA reply is robust. The phase of the modulation is inconsistent and the muon interaction don't fulfill the DAMA requisites. However, we are observing quite a lot of interaction related with muons that we are removing, but we are trying to understand better how these events could be contributing in the low energies. And so we expect also to do some works in this direction in the next future. So how can we do a test of a DAMA-LIBRA experiment with less time and less mass of detection, and also with a worse background? I have to say just that the modulation amplitude is large, but our sensitivity should be enough to do these tests between 3 and 4 sigma confidence level. To go beyond, lowering the background is a must, and then we have to develop a lower background crystals, higher radio purity crystals of sodium iodide. And the most important things, we plan to do our data public to allow for independent analysis, because we really are convinced that sharing the data and procedures is the way to find a solution to this puzzle. Thanks a lot for your attention.
Thank you very much, Marisa, for the nice talk and for the nice results from ANAIS experiment. So mm-hmm. for the people that is following the live transmission, you can write your questions in the YouTube chat. For the moment, we are going to start with maybe some questions from here for the audience in the Zoom session. So if somebody has a question for Marisa, we can start with that question. I'm going to start with the question. Marisa, when you mentioned that ANAIS can contrast the result of the mm-hmm. DAMA-LIBRA 3-sigma, mm-hmm. it's just now that you have this 3 years of period, but at most you expect that ANAIS can rule out at 4 sigmas? Matter of statistics, or?
Yeah, it's a matter of statistics. With time, we improve. But so in our estimates, to reach 5 sigma, we need 10 years. And then this is maybe too much. So we are not really deciding yet how to finish our measurement. But it will depend if there are a better experiment running or not yet. At the moment, I think that we are with cosine, we are the only experiments that are taking data, and then, okay, we can take data for some more years, but really to get to 5 sigma is a very, very long time. So we are speaking about 2017.
Okay, yeah. So another question with regarding in the case of the DAMA-LIBRA modulation is just a systematic issue. I mean, it's not dark matter, it's something else. Is there a way to contrast this, for instance, with other, I don't know, because I know that point that the Canfranc is not in the same latitude than the Gran Sasso, but
almost,
it's closer enough, if it is atmospheric, it should be something.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so in our opinion, if it's atmospheric, but strange, it should be similar to Gran Sasso. If it's atmospheric but related with muons, then it should be much worse in Canfranc, because we have a rock overburden that is lower. And so then if it's related, for instance, with the muon modulation, then we should see the effect. It's true that we are removing these events in our data now, but we are not observing a clear effect in the modulation of muons in our case. So then we are working in this direction, because it's one of the systematics that is more easy to face from our point of view. Other possible systematics are really much more complicated to contrast, because of course our experimental approach is not the same. And so then there are possibilities in the measurements that are not taken into account by the other experiment in the same way. So I will say that there is place to study systematics, but for that the best way will be that DAMA LIBRA will share their data, and the other people look at their data in different ways, and that more information on their acquisition and protocols for filtering, for instance. The filtering is very important in all the experiments working in these energy regions. And the filtering, there is not much information on how is done or which even are removed or kept by DAMA LIBRA. So, but it's not easy from our side, maybe to find the systematic that is explaining the result.
Okay, thanks. I don't know if there is another question from here for the audience. Otherwise, we can go to some question from YouTube, because we have a couple. First, we have one from Karen MC that she's asking, how useful is annual modulation to differentiate between a WIMP signal and the neutrino background and higher energies like atmospheric or DSNB? Kind of if.
No, of course, annual modulation will be very useful if a signal is found. So I will say that the most important question, so it's probably at this rate of improvement in backgrounds in the experiments of dark matter, probably neutrinos will be detected before dark matter. And so if there is enough statistically speaking events, so of course they should be searched for all the possibilities. So I mean, for neutrinos, there will be also some modulation for the solar neutrinos because the distance to the sun is not the same along the year, although the difference is quite small. But I will say that for that the most important problem in this case to compare these effects will be the statistics always. But it will be a very distinctive feature because the amplitude of the modulation is dependent, of course, on the relative velocity with respect to the halo. And this is not shared by atmospheric or solar neutrinos backgrounds. But it's involved. Of course, there are many modulations in when these neutrinos are detected. But the directionality will be also quite very important thing. Probably this is the most interesting experimental issue, to be sensitive to direction, not in global to the annual modulation.
Okay, so there is it's not a question, but it's a comment from Paolo Salucci. He's saying that, first of all, he's congratulating to you. Very, very interesting result. Not crucial, but it is fair to not to claim a standard halo model. We that work on it have got an agreement even at the level of the CASP core issue problem. So he's more or less commenting, yeah. I mean, trying to, about, yeah, when they compare all the data detection experiment with the same halo model.
Of course.
If it is maybe, could be a little, some bias in that assumption.
Of course, no, that is clear that this implies an important bias, and for some, and in the case of the annual modulation, even more than in the comparison of the normal cross-section of interaction, the normal interaction rate. But so it's very difficult to make comparisons allo independent, and so there are some proposals, some ways to try to do comparisons. So in our case, of course, the question is that to test DAMA LIBRA modulation, we have to assume the same. DAMA LIBRA modulation result is compatible with the standard halo modulation. Yeah, but it's true that if we don't know how is the halo, we should face the problem on the contrary. If we detect an annual modulation, we could use the result to test the halo models.
Yeah. So also in that sense.
Some way, yeah.
Yeah. Also in that sense, since the DAMA LIBRA is claiming an annual modulation, they are claiming with the standard
halo. Of course.
Halo. Yeah. So.
Yeah, at least not any halo is compatible with the DAMA LIBRA modulation.
Exactly. So there is no issue related to the animal modulation itself. I mean, you're comparing the same animal model with the same initial setup. No, so.
And this is because of that our comparison is model independent, because so if we put the same detector with the same target in the same place, we should observe the same modulation. So we are not assuming anything about the interaction mechanism or the Hallow model. The only problem that I mean with our comparison with the Malibra is really the energy scale. If the quenching factor, for instance, is not the same for the Malibra detectors and for our detectors, our energy region from 1 to 6 kV could be different, because we would have there an uncertainty in the scaling of the detector. But this is a quite very different problem with respect to the comparison with other experiments, where the model dependencies are really inside of the calculation of the interaction rates. And so because of that, we think that our comparison is important, and we should check really these very small questions that are still to be fixed.
Yes. So I don't know if there are other questions, because also we have another question about the how is the DAMA LIBRA, ANAIS for the total cross section regarding the spin independent cross section, like
our analysis.
Yes. So I mean, not the annual modulation, but if it is planned for the
to release. So in principle, our background is really much worse than the background of most of the experiments in the field. I have said before, I will show you again the plot of the comparison between the different experiments searching for dark matter. So we are not competitive at all with the most of the dark matter searches, because these detectors have a background which is quite large. Also, DAMA LIBRA background is large with respect to most of the more sensitive experiments searching for dark matter. So we are not aiming at doing a real exclusion in the parameter space, because we cannot compete with most of the experiments in the field. But in principle, our sensitivity should be similar to that of cosine experiment. You can see here the plot, because our background is really very similar to that of cosine. So in principle, we should be at this level, at the level of the Malibra signal, that is at the level of our backgrounds, that in all the sodium iodide present experiment is at this level. But so in principle, we have not tried up to now to do this model dependent effort, because we think that is not really interesting to compare with the Malibra. It's much more interesting focus on our annual modulation result, which is model independent. This plot is model dependent also for sodium iodide, because we are fixing an interaction cross-section scheme, but we are not better than 10 to the minus 42 centimeter square of cross section. So, I mean, this is really limited by the background, and so then this is our limitation. We cannot go further if we don't change the crystals, I mean.
Yeah, also if you don't increase the volume of, So, and a small question also, because many of these other experiments, they try to use also the cross section regarding to electrons. In the case of crystal, can be done this type of analysis, or is because usually it's for xenon kind of liquid.
They have considered this Migdal effect. They refer to this question, no? That they use the energy released to the electrons in the material in order to get also information at lower energies, but in principle, in our case, we will we have focused up to now. So of course, this will take this into account for the final analysis with the 5 years, in order to take all the possible take out all the information possible from our data. But But I mean, for the comparison with DAMA LIBRA, it shouldn't be important, because if this effect is happening, it's happening in DAMA LIBRA detectors and also in our detectors. So we are looking globally at the scintillation light produced by any particle that is releasing energy in the detectors. So in principle, for our comparison, I should say that this is not much important. It's important to do this this analysis in the in the model dependent way, and well, okay, we will try to look if this we could be sensitive to some of these proposed effects that have not been confirmed by measurements that have been only proposed to be there. But I should say that it's not the most important thing in our case, that we are so background limited that we are really very, very low sensitive to this kind of special effects. Xenon experiments are really another order of magnitude of a ground. So you can see here the several orders of magnitude they can reach in cross section.
Okay, so I don't know, in YouTube, we don't have other questions. I mean, Paolo Salucci is saying thanks. When you answered it, you comment about that.
Okay.
I don't know if there are other questions from here for the audience, if they want to ask to Marisa. Otherwise, we are in the time to close the transmission. So we thanks Marisa for such a nice webinar and such an important result with the ANAIS experiment. And for the people that is following us in YouTube, please, you can consider to subscribe also to be updated. I mean, to keep update with the following webinar that is more or less in 2 weeks, the webinar 117. And for the moment, we can say goodbye to everybody and see you in the next time in lawphysics. Ya, terminé el streaming. Quedó.